night there was no moon in sight. You know the stars ain't shining cause the sky's too tight. Heard the scary wind, I seen some ugly trees. There was a werewolf honking along the side of me. I'm mean and I'm bad, you know I ain't no sissy. Got a big titty girl here by the name of Chrissy. Talking about her in my bike.
Hey everybody, welcome to this show. I'm the host, Mike Dooner. Happy Zappa Halloween week. It's Hallows Eve, 10:30. I got a very special guest, Dale Bozzio from Missing Persons, Mary from Joe's Garage. She was a Thingfish, big Frank Zappa disciple like myself. So very excited to have her on today. She'll be in just a minute. Thanks to Stephen Perkins from Jane's Addiction, Porno for Pyros. We had such a cool conversation yesterday. If you didn't see it, go check it out. He's a great guy, a lot of energy, more energy than me. So that was a lot of fun. Thanks to John and Jason on Wednesday. We had a great little jaunt down Fish Halloween history. Went through all of the modern day 10 Fish shows, and that was a lot of fun. And looking forward to tomorrow with the Fish broadcast, dinner and a movie. We're going to see the 2014 set. Then we're going to get the remaining light set pro shot. Can't wait for that. And then what's the last one? I forget what the last one is. I Rock is the third set. So looking forward to that with Fish. Thanks to the Dooner Life. He came on 2 weeks ago. Steve, he's got a webcast coming up on December 12th. Everyone should go check that out on Facebook and on all the social media outlets. If you sign up by, I think it's the end of the first week of December, you get a free VR headset for the 360-degree virtual experience for the Dude Show. So go check that out. I'm looking forward to it. Definitely going to be there. So hey, Steve, can't wait. Hey to Ike and Denise. Can't wait to talk to you tomorrow, Ike. We'll get your message over to Miss Bozzio when she comes on. Hi to my wife and to Becca. Happy Halloween, everybody. Here we go. Dale Bozzio. Hey, Dale.
Hello.
Happy Halloween Eve.
Happy Halloween Eve. Exactly.
Yeah. Welcome to Dooner's World.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much for coming on today. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. Nice to see you.
So how are you feeling today? It's rainy and cold here in New York. How's it?
I'm great. It's a perfect day in L.A., as every day in L.A. is the perfect day.
Sorry. You've been out there for a while now, huh?
Yes, I have.
But you started things back here near me, right? Medford, Massachusetts?
Well, all the music of Missing Persons was here in L.A.
Right.
So,
but your music...
I'm from Medford.
Right. Now, is that near Braintree? I used to go up to Braintree, Massachusetts for work, and I think I remember seeing signs for Medford.
Yes.
Yeah.
Fine.
Mm-hmm. So I spent some time up in that area. So when you were young, how did you get into music? Well, I know you were a Judy Garland fan.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
my Judy Garland story. As I was young, I was not really into music, only for listening, playing or... recording or what have you, you know. Mm-hmm. I want to be a movie star. That was my claim to fame.
Sure, sure.
It was all about going to Hollywood to where the bright lights were, and I thought that if I walked maybe around town, which I had no idea what the town would look like. But I thought if I maybe walked around town, I might run into some movie stars. And maybe they could put me in a movie or two.
Little like did you know that nobody walks in L.A.
Right. And then I end up singing that song.
That's so funny.
It's absolutely ironic.
It is.
Because I just wrote a book called Life is So Strange, right?
Yeah, I can't wait to read it. Can't wait to read that.
But I read it back to myself. I've been editing it myself, you know, along with my editor. But I'm reading it and I'm laughing, and my son will say, "You're actually reading your own book, laughing."
That's a good sign. If it's entertaining yourself, then that means other people will laugh.
You know, that now there is that song "Walking in L.A." and before that, when I first came to L.A., I was 21. Straight out of Boston.
Right.
And when I got here, I said, whoa, where's all the lights? It was so not lit up. It was definitely not Times Square.
Okay. It's funny for us East Coast people, because I was a similar. Mm-hmm. Like, you grow up and Hollywood has this glow to it that's like worlds away, but it's like, so you think of it all glitz and glitter, and you get there and it's just a town, right?
And everything's like beige.
Yeah, yeah. I had Chris France on from the Talking Heads, and I was reading his book, and he talked about a time when the Talking Heads were on tour in L.A., and they tried to walk somewhere. And he literally said, and I realized nobody walks in L.A. I was like, oh, my God, that's so funny.
I know, right?
It's true, though.
Terry Bozzio and Warren Cucurulla were waiting outside for me in L.A., in Westwood, right? And I'm getting ready to go to come outside, and we're going to drive to the rehearsal. This is in like 79. We rehearsed 6 days a week. We took Sundays off. We were really neurotic. I mean, well, we didn't really have anything else to do.
Hey, let's play. So yeah.
We made it like it was our job, right? So we went to work every day, 6 days a week. And then Sundays we took off. So they'd wait outside for me out front. And finally I came out and they looked at me and went, nobody walks in L.A. And I went, yeah, that's cool.
That's kind of catchy. Right.
Okay. But I was like, I didn't really think much of it. Okay, that's like not so brilliant.
Next thing you know, it's a song. It's part of the zeitgeist. That's so
I mean,
funny.
Even it's so the end of the time, right? You know, I'm in rehearsals with them, rehearsing these songs in these oddest times, rock and roll suspension and this and that and the other, and going, okay, can you count to nine? I go, I think so. I knew not to read or write music, and they got me counting in 11. And all like controversial songs, you know. So I'm going, wait a minute, where's the hit?
Well, from kindergarten to a master class, all of a sudden, right? Boom.
Yeah.
But like, you did it. What, you did
wait,
it.
Where? What's the hit song here? I don't get this. Like, we get some, like, I Like Boys. Like, what? And Destination Unknown, I thought, okay, that's close. Because that's kind of ambidextrous. So that's okay. You know, it's a lot to think about. But I don't know. I'm walking in L.A., I'm like, okay, you know, let's you think about that. And actually, we played it and rehearsed it as they wrote it. And Terry and Warren wrote it. And I sang it. And when we played it, we didn't play it like at the end of the show as it was our anthem. We just played it as it was a little ditty that they wrote, waiting for me outside.
Like, simple enough.
Simple enough. But how odd that it becomes, and then you know what happens to be same thing with somebody that has kind of like well me with that that's thing I do, you know, breathing, singing. It just happened naturally while I would be. Rehearsing or what have you, you know. So
it's authentic. That comes through. It's authentic and part of you, right? So that's the awesomeness of it.
You would just kind of like poop. It would be there, you know, and then Terry would say, "Oh, why do you do that? That just sounds so weird." And then Warren would say, "No, leave it, that'll leave it." And then when Frank heard it, we played Frank. So Frank, let me tell you. So Frank goes to New York and plays Halloween, right? Every Halloween, usually, until he got sick. And then he turned to us. It was about a week before then. And it was a couple of days before. He said, I'm going to New York for Halloween. Do you guys want me, Terry and Warren, he's looking at the three of us. Why don't you take my studio? Now, this is his brand new studio.
Mm-hmm.
He said, you can use my Kurzweil. This is brand new everything, right? And he says, but for one condition, you get to go over to Ken Scott's address.
Mm-hmm.
And he literally said, climb over the fence, he'll be at the pool getting a tan, go get him and tell him to meet you at my house. You three make this demo for Halloween. I'll be gone for a couple days. Make the demo. I'll listen when I get back.
Wow. And it was like any doubt, no doubt about like whether it wouldn't happen or not. He just said it like, this is what you're going to do. This is how it's going to happen. And
absolutely. That's how Frank was.
Yeah.
He was there, exactly. There was no beating around the bush with Frank.
He already fast forwarded to him sitting down listening to the demo in 5 days from then, right? He was here to make that happen.
Yeah. So he sits down. So he comes back. He goes to Hull. He goes, blah, blah, blah. I go over Ken's. I climb over the fence, you know, tell Ken, you know, will you please come and do this and blah, 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 blah. He does. Frank comes back. The first song he listens to is Mental Hopscotch. And he said, that's my favorite song.
Yep. That was Frank's favorite, right?
That's it. Yeah. And that's it. He said, and then after he listened, there were only four songs at the time. Mm-hmm. You know,
I have it over there. It's over there, right there with the album.
And he said, okay, now go to work. That was it.
Right, right.
And we looked at each other and I thought, I thought it was party time now.
Well, no, but it was. That's a green light from Frank saying he liked what he heard and keep going, right? That is kind of party time.
Well, you know, that's what happened when I saw him when he was passing away. I went to see him and sat with him and held his hands and talked to him for a little bit, really for 45 minutes. And he said, I said to him, Frank, what am I going to do now? You're not here and you're not going to tell me what to do. And how will I go on with my musical life or my life? And he would always give me his opinion on my personal life as well, because right. I always would bring it to him. And I said, Frank, what am I going to do? He said, you're going to go get Terry and Warren and you're going to play Mental Hopscotch for me. I literally started laughing just like that, right?
That's so funny.
I started laughing. I was like, what? He said, after you're done singing and you don't want to sing anymore, be a news reporter. Because I used to tell Frank the news all the time.
Really?
Anytime I would be, you know, in L.A. And at the time in L.A., it was really difficult to get the news. You had to read the newspaper. Literally, there was no this computer get info 24/7. You know, the dictionary of life in here, right here, the biggest dictionary in the whole world. No. And then you had to get the news as it was happening, when it was happening. Listening to these little tiny news stations and blah blah blah, and it would drive me crazy because I was just, I don't know what it is, but I love the news. I like to be in the
now. Be informed. You want to know what's going on.
Yeah, but it's happening like live, you know, kind of like a TV commercial. I know you're going to talk to me.
That's so funny. So let's go back to, I want to go back to the beginning. Like, so when you first, tell the story of when you left Boston or Medford to go out to California. Was it February 77? Is that correct?
76.
February 10th, right? 76. Well, that was the date that you were out in L.A.
That was the date I got to L.A.
Right, right.
Good going, buddy. You're right on there. I love details.
Yeah, me too.
So, well, I left about a week before that we left. It was me.
Well, inside the context, too. You were in Playboy at that point, or?
I was working at the Playboy Club then.
Okay.
And, for January 1977, I believe it's 76. I don't know, whatever. I'm in the magazine for Bunnies of 76.
Right.
Bunnies of 76. They have a 76. They don't even put the 19 in front of it. So it could be 1876. Who knows? It's so long ago. But the magazine was out because it had come out earlier. At that time, the magazine would come up, like, I believe, 2 months earlier. It was always ahead of itself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. earlier or later, whatever.
Oh, it must have been earlier. Earlier would make sense. Yeah.
They had a theme, like a way they would get those magazines out. So anyway, my appointment was for Valentine's Day. I was supposed to be the Valentine at the front door and move into the mansion and try to become a centerfold, you know, do the Playboy spread, blah, 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 blah. Mm-hmm. And I was so excited about doing it. I really want, you know, I couldn't wait to get there, obviously.
Sure.
I was really excited. So we drove cross country in Firebird.
What color was the Firebird? Was it red?
Navy blue.
Oh, okay.
Navy blue, black rag top convertible, Recaro seats, stick shift, 5-speed.
Badass.
It was badass. Yeah, it was a 69. I'm a car person. I love cars. I've always loved cars. I wanted to be a race car driver. That was my main objective in life. Go figure.
Too late. It's not too late. You can still do it.
No. I'm over it.
Yeah, past that. Okay.
I'm good. I figured out you could really, really crash into a wall.
Yeah, you can. You absolutely can.
No, I gave it up.
So it took you a couple days to get out there. It must have taken you like 2 days or 3 days or something,
it took
right?
Like about a week, actually.
A week. Oh, you took your time. Okay.
Me and two girls, and I drove the whole way, of course, you know. I'm the driver. So we drove across country, stayed in a couple of places, blah, blah, blah. Got all the way there. And then when we got there, as I said, LA looked so bleak. And the bunny said, what? Where's the Hollywood lights? Where's the parties? Where's all the people? Where is everything? There wasn't even like a tall mall. Buildings were short. I said, well, you know, they have earthquakes here. And they're like, oh, you know what? We're leaving. They literally left the day we got here. They went, stayed one night with me, with my friend Chansky, this guitar player friend of mine, and they left the next day. They just flew off. And they were going to come with me to go to the house.
The mansion.
And they keeled on me.
Wow.
They didn't even come. So, and I end up, wake up, go up to the mansion the next morning.
So now it's February 10th, right? February 10th, 10 a.m., right? 10 a.m. appointment, be on time.
Exactly. That's right, my boy. And I walk in, I see Hefner standing at the top of the stairs around this like staircase. Mm-hmm. He's got a smoking jacket on, his pipe, and I'm looking up there, and I look to the left, and there's a secretary, and she says, hi, Dale, here's your magazine, blah, blah, blah. So I put the magazine under my arm. I said, oh, thank you so much. And then I'm thinking that Hefner's going to begin to walk down the stairs, and he doesn't. He never does. And I said, excuse me, Mr. Hefner, I'm here for our meeting. I just drove 3,000 miles, and I'm really excited to meet you. He said nothing. He never said a word to me.
What did he do?
He said nothing. He waved me with his pipe up the stairs several times. Kind of like hand sign language. Ugh. And I wasn't going for it. Ugh. I just drove 3,000 fucking miles from Boston. Okay, in my Firebird, top of my fucking game.
And this creepy fuck is waving you in.
You know, I had a shoebox full of cash in the back seat that I worked my ass off at the Playboy Club to get. I wasn't doing this for tiddlywinks. This was part of my goal. This was Hollywood. I was going to be a movie star. I had a main objective here. So anyway, what happened was he never came downstairs. He never said anything to me. He never talked to me. And I was getting really aggravated, and I didn't know what to say or do. And I was not going up the stairs.
Right.
I wasn't going up the stairs. I just had I heard so many stories about him and tales of all these little ditties, and I wasn't going for it. I just had this like. I tripped out. I couldn't do it. And I got really upset and said, Mr. Hefner, I got to go. I have a previous engagement. You're obviously not talking to me. See you later. I was so pissed off.
Wow. You go, girl. You go, girl. You're 20 at this point, right? You're 21, 20?
21.
Oh, 21.
I was so pissed off. I said, thank you to the secretary.
That's a badass Boston girl there, though. Come on. That's East Coast. Get the hell out of here with that West Coast bullshit. I love it.
It's so Boston.
Well, and you know, everything you thought was proven true because he did reality shows. We all saw it was exactly the crap you thought it was.
Right? You know what? The thing is, I was so... I was just out of my father's house. I just got let go. You know, I was a Playboy bunny and everything, but I was really living in a bubble for my whole life. I mean, I would say, oh, I think I'll do this. And I did it. And it wasn't very much really, but whatever it was that I would come to my mind that I thought would be right for me, my father raised me and he was always willing to listen to what I had to say about anything at any time of day. And I had no, there were no veils. There were no kind of margins of not thinking one way or the other. My father gave me freedom to think and didn't reprimand me.
That's great. Not a lot of women at that time had that from her fathers, right? A lot of times it was more of that demeaning 50s kind of BS. So that's really cool that your dad was open-minded to give you the freedom to become who you need to become, right?
I think about it now, and I think, how could he bought me that car. I mean, he taught me how to drive. But some people are just like that. If they see something true and it's their hobby or their love of life, or what they believe in, of course they're going to give that to the ones they love.
Yeah,
take
yeah,
it makes to sense. Them, give it to them, share it with them, right?
Absolutely.
They believe in that. Even if you're Dale Earnhardt and you're going to crash into a wall, you're going to share that with the ones you love.
And Junior's keeping his dad alive, right? His heart, spirit alive, right? His son's now keeping Dale Jr., right? He's still running around the tracks and doing it. Yeah.
And look at the faith that he has.
Yeah.
I always look up to those Dales. You know, you gotta love it.
That makes sense.
I've got that kind of close feeling about people with the same name.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Anyway, to
So you tell half no, right? It's not gonna happen.
Size up the story. So I leave there. I get in the car. I just peel out of the mansion.
You must have been fuming at this point. You must have steam coming out of your ears.
I'm speeding now, like in the driveway, right?
Yeah.
And I get out of the air and I fly down Sunset Boulevard. And I've got the talk down. I'm all by myself. I'm on dead E. I don't have my seatbelt on. I'm smoking a joint now, okay? You know, now the joint in the ashtray is now in my mouth. And I'm looking for somewhere I don't know where to go. I'm completely lost. I never was
intense
in that before. I just got here. I drove 3,000 miles from Boston. I don't know where to go.
What do you do? What the hell do you do? Yeah.
So my friend Chansky, the guitar player, who is the only place in every, you know, over here that I knew in L.A., he says, oh, I'm going to be at SIR Studio Instrumental Lots. Come over there if anything goes wrong. Because I know you'll be moving to the mansion. Nothing will go wrong.
So, what could go wrong?
Right. What could go wrong?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. So I'm trying to find this place, right? I'm driving like crazy, like a nutcase, looking for this place. I finally find it. I'm in Hollywood. I'm at this place. Everything looks the same. I'm down this alley. I'm pulling up this car. This guy's yelling at me to move my car. I go, I can't. It's on E. I got to go get some money to get gas in it. Can you just wait a minute? Everybody in LA just seemed really not right to me. They didn't seem in the same pace as Boston.
No, it's not. It was definitely not. Yeah.
No, it was a whole nother shuffle going on out here. And I was kind of feeling it out going, what's going on? How do these people kind of mince? What is up? You know? I mean, I'm only 21 years old, and I'm already like trying to feel the situation out, because I'm thinking, oh, fuck, I'm in L.A. with a car. I got to drive back to L.A. and Boston by myself.
Little did you know you're surrounded by flakes. You didn't know that everybody around you was were flakes, right? Frank would later tell us that, but...
No, at that point, I didn't know. Thank God Frank found me, because if he hadn't found me at that point, who knows what would have happened to me. I mean, who knows where or what? I haven't got a clue. Anyway, so I walk onto this lot, and I hear Frank Zappa singing. I go, what? That's Frank.
And you had met him before. You had met him in like 72 or 73, right?
Two.
Okay, 72 when you played... When you played in Boston, right?
London won't tell us.
Got the poster right here, right there. Love one of my favorites. It's one of my top three Zappa albums is Tour and Motels for sure.
Yeah.
So you met him. So you knew his music. You were a fan, and you're walking in SIR Studios and you hear him. So that's that must have that's nuts.
And I say, okay, I got to go to the music. Now, I'm really whimsical at this moment.
You're like a moth to the light at this point, right? Your soul is just, you got to go here, right?
Yeah, I'm going here, you know. So I looked at the door. There's a big sign on the door. It says, if you value your life, do not open this door. I started laughing. I thought it was hysterically funny. I have an odd sense of humor anyway.
Yep.
So it really made me laugh. Oh. I'll say, well, fine. It looked like a regular door to me, except it was a door, and it was connected kind of to this other big giant panel. Oh, whatever. I don't know. I pushed it. The whole thing went up like a semi-truck door. The whole thing started going up, and it was the rarest moment. Does he break? It break. Was standing there sideways, right? Just in a t-shirt, cotton pants. And he looked, Frank was casual, you know what I mean? Like, even if something really crazily bad happened, he react like casual, like, and then get right on it, you know? Like, I guess he would be a suit, you know, like summing it up.
Right.
And so he looked. Like, turned completely around. He went, what are you doing here from Boston? Not like, what the fuck? Nothing. Like, right like that.
And I recognized you. He recognized you.
Yeah.
You did stand out like that.
Yeah, and I was standing there all by myself.
Right, right.
And I look behind me and I go, Frank. like Dale, get it? He's talking to you. Right. That was so funny. And I started laughing too. And that was the really funniest thing, because that was what we between me and Frank, laughing.
Yeah.
I would make him laugh. I made him laugh.
From the first moment, or second moment, right?
Right. From the first moment. I climbed up three flights of the Orpheum Theater in Boston, right? When the 200 Motels was out. Mm-hmm. It was 1972. Show was sold out, so I had to go up the fire escape to get in, to get to the show. It was the only way it was going to happen, all right? My friend.
I've been there. That's in that alley. The Orpheum's in that alley. I saw Tom Waits there in, like, 99. Yeah. Yeah, really. So you climbed up the fire escape to get into the sold-out show at the Orpheum.
I got two other bunnies. No, they weren't bunnies at the time. Two other girlfriends with me coming up behind me, right? Uh-huh. I said, okay, we're going to climb in the window, and we're going to get backstage, and we're going to be at Frank's show. No problem. I climb up. I open the window's broken. I open the window. Climb in, and I'm on a toilet, standing on a toilet. And I go, oh, okay. I get off the toilet on the ground. There was a tiny, like a closet. That was it. And there was the door. And I went, oh. So I opened the door. And Frank was standing right there. And he went, how did you get in there? I started laughing. I said, Frank, I'm your biggest fan.
That is amazing. So that was the first time you met him. That was the first time you actually met Frank.
First time. Wow. He said, how did you get in there? I said, I climbed up the fire escape and I came in the window. I climbed into the window. And he went, of course you did. And he started laughing. He just started laughing.
Oh, and man.
I can remember it now because that was the whole thing. Like, that made me so happy to hear him laugh. Like,
yeah.
Wow. Because you know how cool laughing, it just like, wow, just the volcano is over. Everything's cool. We laughed. You know, what comes next? Singing, you know, whatever. Life is so just free when you can laugh and be happy. Here's my missing person's cup.
Oh, I love it. Yeah, making Frank laugh was
That was it. So when he opened the door, the semi door, and he turned around and he saw me and he said, and I said, Frank, you remember me? He goes, how can I forget you? Of course.
So you broke in to see Frank both times. First time you broke into the Orpheum, and the second time you broke into his rehearsal. That is just so fucking cool.
Yeah. It's just, I guess you want to call it fate. I don't. I
100%.
I don't have any other clues.
So what did he say? When you broke in, after he said, "What are you doing here from Boston?"
So I said, "Well, Frank," and I had the Playboy with me because I was going to show it to my friend Chansky to say, "See, I told you I was going to be in the magazine," because Chansky was always doubting me and saying, "Oh no, it'll never happen." Oh blah 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 blah. And I'm like, no, it's going to happen because I'm going to make it happen.
Well, that's a good resume. If you're in LA with nothing but a Playboy with you in it, that's a good resume to walk around trying to get a job, right? If you want to be a star, right? Hey, absolutely.
I didn't care about being nude. It wouldn't matter to me. I was not embarrassed whatsoever, so I didn't care, right? I was really flaunty, flirty, a spoiled brat from Medford, and, you know, I had no clue what I was about to be dealing with.
And now you're nose to nose with Frank Zappa, interrupting his rehearsal.
You know, I had no idea. I had no qualms. I was not embarrassed. You know, it took a lot to humble me. So anyway, Frank says, "What are you doing?" I said, "What are you doing here?" I said, "Frank, oh, you won't believe it." I just like completely unloaded on him. That was it.
This crazy story. That's a crazy story to have to tell. Sure.
This was our relationship. Like, this is how it was between me and him. That's why on the end, when I said to him, when I was going to see him again, I said, "Frank, wait, you can't die. What will I do? I'll be lost." And I'm not taking this lightly. I cry every day about Frank, okay? Yeah. One time or another, during 24 hours, I guarantee you, I shed tears for that man. It's absolutely overwhelming to me and announced to me that my life has been led this way. But he has got a tie around one of my ears. And I it doesn't let go, you know. It just doesn't let go. And for all the convolutions and contrary to everything between Frank and I, there was only laughter and music. There was nothing else between Frank and I. Nothing.
And laughter and music equals love, right? I mean, that's if you bring those two together, that's nirvana, right?
But I mean, I think a lot of people thought, you know, what does Frank have this like little 21-year-old, you know, 100-pound like little girl here? What is she doing here? She doesn't even know how to read or write music. Why does he have her? Why is he putting her on Joe's Garage?
Mary on Joe's Garage, hello?
Why is she Mary? Why does he pay her when she just didn't even know how to do a sing or know music? They would all ask me, why do you get paid the same as we get paid? You don't have a master's in music. And I'd say, I know. I make Frank laugh.
Yeah. Yeah. You know? Well, and you playing Mary, if you look, stand back now, 10,000 foot view of what happened. You broke in at the Orpheum, and Frank loved that. Then you break into his rehearsal. So that's Mary. That's like the perfect, I mean, obviously, you know, In his mind, you're crazy. You're crazy. You're hot. You're like, you're everywhere. You're following him. That's just so awesome. It makes so much sense.
And he made him laugh.
He liked ballsy girls. Not like he liked. There's a few women in his life that were gutsy enough to stand up, and he respected that. And looking back, you can see why he chose these people. Pauline Butcher, right? The English secretary who dictated the words to Absolutely Free. He hired her and brought her back to England because she challenged him. And she said, what's this bullshit? Like, she literally called him out on all the songs on Absolutely Free, and he explained them all to her. But he respected her, and it's the same thing. And that's part of the awesomeness of Frank. As much as people don't know that, you know, the depths of the man and the character, because it's not just the titties and beer. You know, it's a lot more than that.
And that's my favorite song.
It's one of mine, too. I was just listening to the Zeppelin New York version earlier. That's my favorite Halloween song, Dale. I think that's my favorite because the devil and Terry and, like,
listen, no one in the whole world is the devil but Terry Bozzio. Terry Bozzio is the baddest ass devil. Yeah. That they have ever seen. Okay. Yeah. Nobody can do what he does. Nobody. And Frank knew it. Frank knew it. And I did a tour with them, did the whole European tour with them, watched Terry night after. I say this in my book, how I watched him night after night be that devil. No one could be that. No one could do. Terry Bozzio's the greatest drummer in the world.
That's a very valid argument. It'd be hard to the physicalness of how he plays. Even watching the titties and beer, I was watching the video of it. And like he stands up and like every drum hit, he's like he's throwing his body.
There's no argument. His timing is beyond imagination. There's no comparison.
And he's ambidextrous too. That's a big point that a lot of people didn't know. I didn't know that until recently. He's ambidextrous, which makes a big difference of how you can articulate the drums.
Terry learned how to play drums on a dime, okay? And he doesn't even talk about it. He can play his sticks on a dime and not click them. Do you know what it takes for a drummer not to click their sticks? You listen from here on out, and you'll hear them all. They click their sticks. They can't be precise enough. He's precise as a deer's breath.
I heard he could write the Lord's Prayer on the end of a pen.
Believe you me. If I had to stake my life, it'd be on Terry Bozzio.
Yeah, no, absolutely, absolutely. Now, Terry toured with the Knack, correct?
He did.
At the end, because I had Prescott on. Prescott, you're the current bass player for Missing Persons, who's amazing. I've had so many great conversations with Prescott. He is just...
Prescott was Greg Chansky's best friend. He still is.
There we go. Oh, right.
You know, Prescott. Now, Prescott's a few couple years older than me, but way back then, even if your boyfriends or the friends were... that like 2 years old or a couple years old, they were like, oh God, they're hanging around with the big boys. You know what I mean? Uh-huh. And me personally, I was always where the musicians were. Wherever I heard music, I just felt, oh, that's cool. Mm-hmm. You know, that's all that works for me. And I was really, I've kind of been on a permanent vacation my whole life. So yeah, I'm always looking for a tune. That, you know, that's about sized up for me.
Right.
But it's so impressive that through all this time, you know, all these songs and Frank and all the people that have come and gone in my life and everything, it's still Frank.
Yeah.
Frank never leaves me. And Frank is the person that said, you know, he always... I don't want to say he kicked me to the curb, but he did. When I first went up to the fire escape and we laughed and that was all a joke and we went out to dinner with my girlfriends and that night I had a 1968 Canary Yellow Delta 88 convertible red black ragtop black interior. And Frank came and jumped in the car, in the convertible, with me and my two girlfriends. I drive them to this hotel. He's staying at the Holiday Inn, right? So he gets out of the car. The girls jump out. They don't even open the door. And he's standing outside the car. And he says, okay, come on. Park the car. And I say, oh, no, Frank. And my girlfriends, they're 18 years old. I say, no, Frank, I can't go to the party. I said, it's 11:45 and I got to be home by midnight. I stole this car from my mother. And I just met her a couple of days ago. I haven't seen her in like 7 years of my life. I just stole her car and I had to come to your concert. I snuck in the window and if I'm not home by 12 o'clock, I'm going to be in serious trouble. She's going to be looking for her car. And I'm only 17, Frank. I don't even have a driver's license. And he went, oh. Uh-oh. So I'm driving Frank in this convertible with no driver's license.
Wow. Right. Badass.
It was so funny. And he just looked at me like, it was like, oh no, like something really back in his head, like it wasn't funny anymore.
His lawyer's phone number all of a sudden came to his mind. He's like, oh yeah.
he stopped laughing and he got so serious. He got like so, like I know now because I know the difference between his self, his funny self and his serious self. I've been in, you know, I've been in the room with him. I was in the room with him for 9 years, you know, not the same, but you know, same room in many places and laughed and cried and so forth and so on. But I saw him get really serious. He backed up. He backed up and he went, no, you can't go to the party. Okay. like it was like, whoa. He got completely changed. He wasn't his jovial, all happy self. And I went, okay, Frank. I just looked at him myself, you know, thinking, I have to tell the truth. I didn't say it out loud, but I was saying it like, you know, just don't be a stupid bitch, Dale. Just tell the truth, you know, just do it. So I said, I got to go, Frank. I really got to go home. I stole this car from my mother, has no idea, you know, I'm out with the top down, it's midnight, smoking pot, and I don't even have a driver's license. And at that point, I could see he, like, fell 10 feet. He was like, oh, my God, Jesus Christ, she doesn't have a fucking driver's license, you know.
He didn't remember that part when you met him a few years later, though, right?
Yeah, he remembered. That's why he remembered me.
Oh, well, maybe that's why he remembered, right?
If you should use it again.
I almost went to jail in 72 because of you.
He's like, oh, no, not you again.
Or he did the math. He's like, okay, now she's 21. All right, now.
Yeah, let me get like that. Give me a minute. Let me add this up. Frank was pretty good at adding.
Yeah.
He was right on. So anyway, he goes, so he said, okay, listen. And he reached over in the car. He said, hey, come here. And he reached over to me. And I thought he was going to give me a kiss on the mouth. Like, that's how childish I was. Right. And he took his two hands, he put them on my shoulders, and he kissed me on the forehead.
Aww.
And I went, what? Like, my father does that. That's all I ever got from my father. Two hands on my shoulder, and kissed me on the forehead. This is like an Italian thing. Mm. This is what your grandfather does. I mean, he curses you or blesses you, either one. Mm. You know, it's the covet. And I went, whoa. Right? Wow. I got this like shock of electricity, which I never knew why it would happen again. But he only did that to me three times in my life. I didn't make love to Frank. I didn't even kiss Frank on the mouth ever in my whole life. And I think, I love Frank more than life itself.
So that was the first. That was the first kiss on the forehead. What was the second?
The second one was, I fell out a window.
Oh, right.
I fell out a window, and when I woke up and got out of the coma, I went backstage again, banged on the door, and said, "Let me into this show." And I got there by the last concert, by the last song of the concert. He was playing with Terry Bozzio at the time. And they let me in. I said, I got to see Frank. I got to see Frank. And when I walked into the back, it was his last song. And he came and he grabbed me by the shoulders and he kissed me on the forehead. And he said, you're beautiful.
Aww.
I love you. And I said, no, no, no. I'm not beautiful anymore. I was beautiful. I'm not beautiful anymore. And I'm fucked up, Frank. I fell 40 feet out of a window. I landed on my head out of a Holiday Inn, and it was a long story. And Frank said, no, 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 everything's going to be all right. And you want to come with us tomorrow? We're going to Europe. We're going to go on tour. I can't go on tour tomorrow. I'm walking at home. How is it supposed to be not here? I just stole my mother's car again. This game. Fucking car. I stole the last time to come and see you, and then I get flipped back here 6 months later, and you want me to go back and do this all over again?
That's so funny.
Literally, that is what happened. That night, I couldn't see to drive. I'm still recovering from being in a coma and having this fucking blood clot in my head and like all kinds of really bad problems. I broke my kneecaps. I broke my floating ribs. I was like struggling. I was using a cane, an umbrella as a cane. And Frank said, no, no, you can go. I said, yeah, all right. Okay. If you can say I can go, I'm going to go.
Yeah.
I'm going to go. I turned 22 because after I fell out the window, I went into this coma, slipped into the coma, had to get shipped back to Boston, be in the hospital, recover from all this, whatever went down my head.
Mm-hmm.
And I got all better and tried to just was going to be normal again. And then Frank said, no, 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 come with me. And I thought twice and said, okay.
I'll go. So you went on tour? You went on tour?
I left.
Wow.
I went back to my house that night with the car. My cousin was driving it for me, Candy. I got back there and my mother said, oh, you didn't do that. I said, oh, yeah, I did. And I'm leaving tomorrow. I'm going to England.
Wow.
She said, no, you can't go. No, you can't go. You fell out the window. No, you can't walk. I said, I will walk again. And I'm leaving. And I left the next day. I did.
What year was this? Was this 88? No, 70 still.
No, no, it was 78.
78,
the
okay.
End of 78. So we go to Europe. I go with them. I'm not married to Terry yet.
Okay.
I get married to Terry in 79. Yeah, I believe. So I go to Europe with Frank. That's it. I'm on tour with Frank and Terry, I watch Terry be the devil night after night all over Europe, Germany, Switzerland, Vienna.
It's insane.
All the restaurants and everywhere we go, and Frank is treated like a king, and we stay at the best hotels in the whole world.
That's a good way to heal from an injury. Did you have any problems from the injury while you were there?
Oh, yeah, I was fucked up. Let me get this, like, codeine, and you could get medicine over the counter there. That was a little more, it was easier. And I weaned myself off of the morphine. And Frank, I had a soft spot for me. So if I ran off and smoked weed, he didn't see it.
Wow. You're the exception.
He didn't see it, or if he did, he didn't tell me.
Right, right, right.
You know, he did write that song, Dance Your Little Dance, Smoke Your Little Smoke,
Absolutely did, yeah.
I think he was talking to me. I don't know. I think everything that Frank said, he was talking to me anyway.
Yeah, you resemble a lot of the songs if you think back.
that's how I take it. I take everything that Frank says is information. Information is knowledge. Knowledge is wisdom, right? So I take it all so deeply, and I cry. I tell you every day. I have his picture. It sits on the wall right in front of me too. But I surround myself by everything of Dale because he told me, "You're the most important thing here. Pay attention to that. You are irreplaceable. Everyone else is replaceable." That wow. is a heavy cross to bear.
That is.
I can't quit because Frank gave me all of this. He gave me missing persons.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me?
No.
Really?
No.
Really, God? Really?
Eddie, are you kidding me? No, I'm not kidding.
Really? No, I'm not kidding. and stop? I don't think so.
No way.
I don't think so.
No, that's any way. Reason,
when he told me, pick yourself up, get back up on your stack and your horse, and you come with me. And when we got to Rome, I'll tell you this, if I'm talking too much, you can tell me.
No, please.
We got to Rome. He said, okay, I'm going to make you a deal. I said, uh-oh. Right there with Terry Bozzio and Patrick O'Hearn, he said, you go right now today, climb up the stairs of the Sistine Chapel, go all the way to the top, okay? And then I want you to tell me that she looked over the side. It's 500 and so many steps. You got to climb up this claustrophobic little crawl space all the way up the top in the middle of Rome and look over the top. It's like you see the whole everything that you can even think of, and you breathe this air that you can't breathe unless you go up there. All right?
Got it.
I did it. I went all the way to the top. I went with them.
Mm-hmm.
And Terry said, okay, go ahead. We'll go over the side, and so we can go tell Frank that you did it. I inhaled, and I looked over the side, and I came back, and I went, oh, my fucking God, okay? Oh, okay, I better do that again. I had to do it again. And I did it. Whoa. And I did it. I did it. I was afraid of heights. You got to understand. I felt.
I am as well. So I felt that when you're just telling that story. I'm afraid of heights too. Yeah.
I fell 40 feet out of a window, man. Are right. you kidding me? I was scared. I still can't sleep in the dark.
Yeah.
It's been fucking 40 years. I fell out the window September 10th, 1976. Not very long, you know, after the first jaunt with making the Joe's Garage and doing that whole thing. So when yeah. Frank took me there, he did me a great honor of putting up with my idiosyncrasies.
Mm-hmm.
Frank gave me more than money could buy. I don't know however else to explain it to you.
I agree. And I've more recently been able to kind of express it more. Right, so I've had that love since I was very young of Frank's music, and it's always been a big part of who I am. But now I really have an outlet to kind of tell people and talk to Ike Willis. Oh, Denise and Ike send love. I was supposed to do that at the beginning of the show. I was texting with Ike because he's coming on the show tomorrow, and he said,
"Oh my boy, Ike.
Tell my sister Denise and I love her and miss her." That's from Ike Willis to you.
Oh, and me too. I love them so much. Oh, God bless them. Oh, God bless.
I feel like I'm blessed with Frank's spirit being able to talk to people like you and Ike and Arthur Barrow on. And you know, I'm filled with Frank too, with the love of the music, and I can't get enough. I wake up, I listen to it. I'm thinking about it before I go to sleep. You know, integrating it into my music. I'm starting to write music now. So I'm feeling the love. And so number three, kiss number three, we had the first, then we had the second, after your accident. Was the third, I'm assuming, towards the end?
The third is at the end. The third is the end. I see him in L.A. at his house. You know, I can't remember the date. That's the one date I don't remember. And I couldn't ask Gail because Gail has now passed away. The only one that we remember. It's about a week or two before he passes away. So what happens is I go to his house. I sit down with him, and Gail, his wife, says, okay, you've got 45 minutes to talk to him. So we talk, and we talk about a few things, and, you know, I'm just talking about myself, really. And, you know, and I think, like, after, I thought to myself, Jesus, Dale, you're so fucking selfish. All you just sitting there is asking him what you're going to do without him. Because he's going to die, and you're going to be here left without him. And so,
well, I'm sure he didn't want to talk about his disease, so I'm sure he'd rather hear about you in that situation.
I said to him, I said, Frank, I said, if everything you have right now was all taken away from you, but you could get it right back, would you take it right back? He said, I would. I said, do you have any regrets, Frank? Any? He said, no, none.
Wow.
It hit me like a brick. I went, okay. Okay, Frank. Now I'm thinking, his wife is sitting right to my left. His wife. Okay? For all these years, listening to every word. Every word. Me thinking this whole time only about myself and Frank, not thinking, is she thinking, did she think that I ever slept with Frank? A lot of people think I did. Right. Because they think, why this little girl, why would Frank cater to this tiny little girl that's just like some fucking stupid chick from Medford? You know, not that Medford is stupid, because Medford is full of incredible great people. There's some incredible iconic, I'll tell you about that in a minute. But on Wikipedia, if you go to Medford, the Black Dahlia is from Medford.
Interesting.
She's on the notable persons, Wikipedia, Medford. Her name and my name are listed together. That's Black Dahlia.
That's awesome.
Neil Bowes. A notable person from Medford. Are you kidding me? And I think like the coach or something for the Red Sox. There's some incredible people on this list. It would blow your mind. Like I was like, oh wow, my father would faint. He would faint. Anyway, where was I?
We were you were talking to Frank and Gail was there. Gail was listening.
Yeah. So I say, Frank, as I told you this already, I don't know what I'm going to do. He tells me to get Terry and Warren together and play Mental Hopscotch. I said, Frank, that's going to take me a lifetime. A lifetime. He said, you have a lifetime. I said, okay. Now, he made me believe I'm going to live a long life, you see. He embedded things in me, even on his deathbed. Death chair, death couch. He set me up again. He just kept setting me up.
Yeah.
And I analyzed, like, you know, his last words to me. I what else can I do? I'm like a little kid in a candy store.
Yeah.
I'm trying to buy the Tootsie Rolls. Like, but should I? You know, should I get the Bullseyes? Like, I'm one of those, 24/7. If you tell me, that's why Frank and I worked so good on even everything he made me play on. He'd say, okay, laugh. I go, he'd say, stop. I'd stop. Like, I was a putty, as the rest of all the musicians were. But I did it as a character.
Right.
I did it as a caricature. Didn't really necessarily started singing and pulling out these notes out of myself until even after the fact. Right. You know, I'm really accurate when it comes to, you know, giving you a monologue, as Frank gave me that piece to recite, because he loved the way I spoke, and he designated everybody to what they did best.
Yeah.
That's what he did. And then so I picked this like little puzzle piece. I was just a niche and a notch, but I felt super important.
What a lot of people, that was Frank did. Frank made them become what they couldn't become without him. Right. Ruth Underwood said that. She said a direct quote. There's like she was very musical, but she's like, I couldn't do what Frank made me do. So without him, I wouldn't have been able to become what I was supposed to become. Right. So and almost every musician seems to have some semblance of that kind of story.
They all say that, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. Which is great. I mean, that shows the power of Frank and
yeah, that's
far he's reached. That's why he'll never die. He'll never die because he's alive in you, alive in me. And, you know, we're keeping it alive.
Yeah, it's the school of Frank. It's the thought pattern of where he was at. Because he was very honest.
Yeah.
He was extremely truthful. I mean, you can't be a dishonest person if you're a musician. You can't. You have to be so free and aloof and in the now and the moment to make the notes and the timing and everything exactly work and be effective.
100%.
And correctly. 100%. And done correctly. Done correctly. So, you know, with that in mind, I mean, you knew if you walked in with mud on your face, Frank was going to tell you that.
Yeah, no doubt. So back to your last moments with Frank then. So what do you think? Okay. That was when the last kiss happened?
Yeah, so he says, what? What did you say?
Was that when the last kiss happened, right? And during this encounter, right?
Absolutely. So it's so crazy how I can talk this to you as if it happened yesterday.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of crazy. But I love the tapestry on your wall over
Thank
here.
You.
It makes me feel so at home. I'm just like something about it. It's just like
You're very welcome in Dooner's world, always.
Yeah, it's really smooth, man. But then we talked about let me think what else I said.
He told you to play mental hopscotch, right? Go get boring.
Yeah. Yeah. And then I asked him about his regrets and he said he had none and mm-hmm. and then I said I'm thankful to you, Frank, for everything you've given me, and I'm couldn't be me without you. You made me what I am, Frank. And what can I do? What can I do for you? Can I please stay here and wash your hands? I need to help you. He said, No, you have to go, and I won't see you again. This will be the last time I see you for now, or something like that. Like he left it open-ended, you know, like I'm thinking you're going to die. You think I'm going to see you on the other side? I'm thinking like I wanted to say it, but I didn't. Like, I can say it now. Like, I wanted to say that so bad. Like, Frank, what are you fucking thinking? You know, I couldn't because I didn't want to hurt his feelings.
Right.
You know what I mean? I didn't want to make him think that I thought, I didn't even want to make him think that I thought he was going to die.
Right.
That's fucked up, you know, but I didn't want him to think that I thought that it was the end. I didn't want that.
It's instinctual. It's a human instinctual thing. Nobody wants to.
Yeah,
when it's right there.
Yeah.
Right?
And so I said, Frank, can I stay here, please, with you? He said, no, you're going to have to go, and everything will be all right. And just go, and you'll be all right. And he said, the torture never stops. But I'll see you again.
Wow.
And he took me by the shoulders. He kissed me on the forehead. I was saying he was crying.